thank you all for coming to the Center for Marxist Education. I'm Doug Greene, a volunteer here, and I'll be delivering today's lecture. Just to let you know, we have a few, just to my knowledge, two upcoming events. There's on the 11th here, I believe there's something in support of Chelsea Manning. And on the 16th, which is, I guess, a week from Monday, there's an event on the 50th anniversary of the Chinese Cultural Revolution, which is the actual 50th anniversary, May 16th. Let's start. So before I start this lecture, my next one, which will be a month from now, on the first Saturday of June, will be on Machiavelli. And in terms of writing this, most of the lectures I've given for this talk have been either very dense theoretical subjects of one sort or another, or glorious struggles that have gone down in heroic defeat of one sort or another. Very few of them have happy endings. This is probably the closest my series has ever gotten to a happy ending, with Marxism becoming the predominant force on the French far left, as one starts out very small and fragmented. And part of the reason I finally was able to approach this, having written on Blanqui and other forms of 19th century French radicalism, some version of this should have been the end of that book, but a book on Blanqui actually ended very well with his death, and I hadn't done the research that would justify another chapter at that point. So I finally came back to this, and part of the reason was reassessing the French Marxists, who in many respects were very vulgar, class reductionist, deterministic. They have no real notable theorists. Jules Guillet is not a good theorist at all. But it came out, I should also add, I'm speaking just for myself, for no organization, not the CME. It came out on a debate I had on Facebook with, yes, where I have a lot of debates with people. I was explaining a conversation I'd had with a Bernie Sanders supporter, and I was explaining how Sanders was not actually a socialist. And someone was objecting to me, and who I believe is in some Trotskyist group, saying, well, Sanders is a socialist. And we went back and forth on this for a little bit. I mean, the other person was obviously wrong, but it got me thinking. The French socialists got a lot of things wrong. Well, one thing they got right is they actually knew what socialism was, and they did not cease to talk about it. They did not cease to propagate it. And however vulgar their understanding is, that was something they got right. And that's, I guess that's where we begin. So, we can start with the rise of Marxism in France, and this is not an overly long talk, thankfully. So in the late 19th century, despite the ascendancy of Marxist-led socialist parties across Europe, it was not inevitable that Marxism would become the hegemonic trend on the French left. France possessed a rich and vibrant revolutionary history from 1789 to the Paris Commune that produced many vibrant movements, figures, and ideologies who all contended for the allegiance of the working class. One of the most prominent was the Blanquist trend of Jacobin communism, who embraced and pledged fealty to the French revolutionary heritage. Yet the Blanquists remained tied to a dying form of politics, focused on elitist conspiracies and remembrances of the past, which was unable to adapt to the possibilities of the present. The growth of capitalism in France created a growing and combative working class that French Marxists, led by Jules Guillet, managed to successfully appeal to. Despite their vulgarization of Marxism as a dogmatic and deterministic theory of inevitable revolution, their sectarianism, and many political missteps, they understood better than any of their socialist rivals that working class politics was no longer based on sex or conspiracy, but on developing mass and independent political parties who engage in broad-based public agitation on both the national and international levels. Through their revolutionary faith, ceaseless organization and agitation, the French Workers' Party was able to organize the proletariat of France into a class party that not only challenged the rule of capital, but steeled them to fight for the inevitable victory of socialism. Although the French Third Republic was the third largest industrial power in Europe before 1914, its development remained uneven, despite trends towards centralization and concentration of capital. Agriculture and small shops continued to dominate the French economy. According to the historian Arnaud Mayer, during the Third Republic, land claimed between 40 and 45% of the active population and generated between 30 and 35% of national income, or about 40% of the total national product. More than 6 million peasants owned less than 2.5 acres of land, comparatively close to the poverty, and had to sell their labor for supplementary income. By 1906, small properties between 2.5 and 25 acres accounted for 75% of all production units. These small plots of land accounted for less than 30% of all cultivated land and were mostly family operated. Despite the militancy of some rural regions, their capacity for collective self-defense and scattered workers was generally low. Large landowners in France of over 100 acres and averaging 400 acres covered between 40 and 50% of the cultivated land. They totaled only 4% of the production units, but they were the leading sector of commercial agriculture. Even by the eve of World War I, 23 million out of 35 million people, or close to 55% of the French population, still lived in the countryside, most in settlements of less than 2,000. However, the number of people living in rural areas increases to nearly 60% if communities of less than 4,000 are included. A great deal of industry was located in the countryside, relying on water power and wood fuel. The large rural population provided a steady influx of workers to industries in the major cities, who were often willing to work for low wages. For example, the textile industry in Normandy and major cities like Lyon relied on fresh workers from the countryside. France only possessed 4 million industrial workers in 1890, rising to 5 million by 1914. However, the working class was not concentrated principally in heavy industry, but largely employed in household and handcraft shops. In 1896, 36% of workers were employed in industries employing less than 5 workers, and another 36% in industries of 50 or more workers. Yet France saw growth accelerate of larger industries as the Second Industrial Revolution took hold. France also doubled her railway network during this period. By 1910, the number of craft workers had fallen to 900,000, while workers in industrial companies rose to 4.5 million. While France did possess large enterprises, most of these were in capital goods and mining, meaning that the economy was composed overwhelmingly of small firms. The capital goods sector of the economy rose from 13% in 1870 to 25% in 1913. There's also notable expansion in chemical production and coal output. Consumer manufacture continued to hold a predominant place in the economy, claiming 72% of industrial workers, while capital-heavy goods employed only 18%, or about 1 million. Furthermore, commerce, trade, banking, and transport employed 2.3 million workers and proprietors, while another 500,000 white-collar workers worked for the government. The number of shopkeepers in France remained steady from the Third Republic from 1870 to World War I, around 700,000. At the outbreak of World War I, France also had developed a major automobile industry, which was largely concentrated in Paris and employed about 33,000 workers. A great deal of the workers recruited during this period of the Second Industrial Revolution were women, immigrants, and rural migrants. And women actually made up 40% of all domestic workers in Paris by World War I. While living standards improved slightly during the 1880s, as the first social safety measures were introduced, unemployment did remain high. Although real wages grew by 25% from 1873 to 1896, wages increased less than the rate of productivity. Lastly, French unions, which were legalized only in 1884, remained small in comparison to those of Britain, Germany, and even the United States, reaching a million members only in 1912. But they were actually politically quite advanced, guided by various forms of revolutionary syndicalist ideology. There was a continued trend of urbanization in the Third Republic, with a total of 7.5 million people living in cities by 1914, compared to 2.5 million in 1870, and 44 cities numbered over 50,000. Despite the regional disparities and uneven development of French capitalism, it was still one of the leading powers in Europe. The increase in monopolies led to the export of capital and imperial expansion throughout the globe. Capital investments, so from 1876 to 1914, France had expanded its overseas empire, adding 3.5 million square miles, chiefly in North Africa in Southeast Asia. Colonial rivalry between France and other nations led to the alliance systems, the expansion of armies and navies. For instance, France maintained a standing army of nearly 1 million by 1914, compared to, say, 1.5 million in Russia. Now, French Marxists and Blanquists respond to these socioeconomic developments and trends in very different ways. For the Marxists, the evolution of capitalism was confirming Marxist predictions that France was becoming more and more clearly defined between workers and capitalists. The workers, in turn, were growing more and more impoverished, despite evidence to the contrary, rebelling against the bourgeoisie, and were ready to carry out the task of leading the struggle for socialism. Yet the Marxists exaggerated the pace of concentration and centralization of capital. At the same time, they ignored or minimized countervailing factors, which did not easily fit in their framework. All this being said, the Marxists were correct that the working class was the force of the future. Therefore, they sought to popularize their scientific socialism amongst them so the proletariat would take up its historical mission. Yet the Marxists faced the difficulty of becoming a mass party comparable to German socialists, since France remained a country of small-scale industry with a working class minority. Thus, they were trying to appeal to people who did not exist in large numbers, and their steady growth was largely a reflection of this misperception. By contrast, the Blanquists were oblivious to all these developments, remaining tied to a conspiratorial and Jacobin vision of revolution, resting on a basis of craft workers and small shopkeepers. The Blanquist conception of elitist politics was quickly being superseded in the new era of mass politics. Now, in 1870, France had established its Third Republic, which bore the scars of its burning military defeat at the hands of Imperial Germany, who annexed the provinces of Alsace and Lorraine, the revolution of the Paris Commune, which was put down without mercy. Throughout the life of the Republic, its ruling classes feared the specter of further red revolution at the hands of the dangerous classes, and they yearned for revenge against Germany. Although the chances for a restoration of the monarchy ended following the elections of 1877, the exiled dynasty still yearned and plotted for the downfall of the godless republic. By the 1880s, France was governed by the opportunistic republicans, who favored moderate social and political reform. Yet the opportunistic regimes, despite their commitment to the republic, were marked with instability, corruption, political patronage, and scandals. They were opposed by the radical party, who were only radical so long as they were losing elections or not offered a ministerial portfolio, after which they became indistinguishable from the opportunists. Throughout the 1880s, France suffered from the Great Depression in the 1880s, as workers suffered privation and unemployment. The class struggle was also reviving in France. Following the election of a Republican government, there was an upsurge in strikes in 1879 and 80, because the workers had the belief that they would receive sympathetic treatment from Republican prefects in struggles against large, often royalist employers. However, the Republic proved itself just as merciless as any royalist government in using violence to quell strike. The following decade, there were major strikes in 1884 and a near insurrection in 1886. And despite their small numbers, the Marxist message found a receptive audience in the ranks of the proletariat who were fighting a war with their employers. Now, the French working class movement had been decimated following the bloodletting of the Commune. Organized expressions of socialism, such as the First International, were banned and unions were driven underground. By the mid-1870s, the first revival of the labor movement occurred, but possessed a decidedly non-political character. The stabilization of the Republic in 1875 or so, which granted universal male suffrage, heartened workers and opened the door to future political action. Jules Guide and the first Marxists, who were still very loosely organized, saw the potential of workers organizing not only economically but politically. A further Republican victory in 1879 led to a wave of strikes and more political agitation by the Marxists. In a climate receptive for political action, the Marxists organized for demands that had widespread appeal amongst workers, such as amnesty for the commune arts. The campaign for amnesty centered on the release of the imprisoned Louis-Auguste Blanqui, an elder revolutionary statesman and symbol of working class struggle. Following two successful and annulled elections of Blanqui in 1879, he was released, shortly followed by amnesty for the commune arts. Another demand which gained acceptance among workers was for an independent labor party to represent their interests. Shortly after the amnesty, Guy played a major role in forming the Federation of the Socialist Workers of France, but the Marxists split from the reformists in 1881 to found the French Workers' Party, which is the first Marxist-led socialist party in France. That same year, the Blancs created the Central Revolutionary Committee, or the CRC, as their own political organization. For the next decade, the Workers' Party and the CRC would vie for leadership of the revolutionary left. Now, following Blanqui's death in 1881, the movement he founded continued to organize and explore the possibilities for revolutionary action in a changed climate. However, whereas the politics of Blanquism, a tightly organized conspiracy that aimed to carry out a revolutionary coup, possessed some logic under the July monarchy and the Second Empire, that was no longer the case in the Third Republic. The Republic saw not only amnesty for the commune arts, the rise of the modern labor movement, but the establishment of a long-lasting Republican regime in which socialists could participate. This was an era of mass politics, not underground conspiracies. The Blancs organized into the CRC needed to find their way in this new environment where they were just one of many competing currents. Despite their atheist and rationalist philosophy, the Blancs became guardians of the revolutionary tradition, celebrating anniversaries of the past and treating Blanqui and people like him as martyrs and saints. The Blancs hoped that by keeping the memories of the struggle alive, that they could reignite the Jacobin and revolutionary spirit amongst the people in order to spur them into action. Honoring the memory of the revolutionary tradition allowed the Blancs to keep that faith alive amongst their militants. Yet their perspective was fundamentally backward. There was no critical analysis of the commune or Blanqui, just a commemoration of myths and legends. In effect, Blancism became a secular religion. Nor did they possess a well-thought-out theory to understand reality or to guide them in political struggles. Some Blancs, such as Edward Valiant, had been in contact with Marxism while living abroad and understood the changes of mass politics using elections, newspapers, and other forms of propaganda. This meant Valiant was moving away from Blanc's insurrection and drawing close to Guide, and he was actually embracing an early form of revisionist Marxism, which angered traditionalists in the movement. Still, no group inside the CRC had a viable long-term strategy for revolutionary change. They could only look to their martyr dead and hope for an apocalyptic revolution that grew more unlikely as time passed. This was in contrast to other socialist parties and organizations that were springing up in France. There were several reformist socialist groups such as the Possibilists, concentrated in the Federation of Socialist Workers. There were also syndicalist movements such as the Revolutionary Socialist Workers' Party, which was formed in 1890. All of them, along with the Marxists, were attuned to the potential of mass politics. For the Blancs, who were drawn into present-day politics, they utilized elections as just one form of action. Yet elections became a focal point upon which all their other activities converge. In the process, their energies, for all practical purposes, transferred from revolutionary agitation to political participation. Yet the Blancs lacked a class focus like the Marxists. They turned instead to populism, which was something that could be found in Jacobinism, which was an expression of protest against the current trend of large-scale economic organization. Its common denominator was an anxiety about the social implications of rapid industrial concentration in a country in which artisan industry had long been the predominant mode of economic organization. As the possibilities of revolution receded from their vision, the Blancs saw their task as joining with other groups who shared their populist sympathies. The stage was now set the disastrous Blancs embrace of the right-wing Boulangist movement. But before that, throughout the 1880s, the Workers' Party remained small and isolated, but they were driven by a profound faith in the inevitability of socialism. French Marxists had to contend with a vastly different situation than socialists face in Germany or Austria, where formal political freedoms didn't exist. In France, Marxism had to contend with different schools of socialism, which made it difficult for Marxists to distinguish themselves and gain a hearing. Despite their adherence to Marxism, the Workers' Party, understanding that theory was eclectic, superficial, and shallow, and vulgar. Guide and the Workers' Party convinced that Marxism offered a more objective approach to the social question, one which drew its insights not from the revolutionary experience of the past, but from the new science of society. For the Workers' Party, Marxism offered a science of history which explained the logic and laws of capitalist development that led inevitably to crises and collapse. Capitalism, in building up the productive forces, concentrated wealth and simplified class contradictions, laid the basis for socialism. Once Marxism permeated its natural proletariat constituency, once the Workers' Party had fulfilled its historic mission of propaganda and organization, the liberation of labor would follow unproblematically. According to the Marxists, for the proletariat to carry out their mission, it was imperative for them to constitute themselves into a Workers' Party with the aim, one, the capture of political power, and two, the seizure of capitalist property to restore it to the national collective. It was with a missionary zeal that the Workers' Party spread this gospel. During the 1880s, the Workers' Party's fervor burned bright despite their lack of success. The party remained weak in Paris, which is the center of political life. They did poorly in elections and had difficulty maintaining a journal in the capital. The party possessed a small constituency within the unions for about 10 years, after which they lost these supporters due to their opposition to the general strike. The Workers' Party was overwhelmingly a male party, and by the 1890s, only about 3% of their members were women. During this period, the party remained largely a sect, barely exceeding 2,000 members. The party's focus on the industrial workers meant that only 7% of its members were peasant origin. Yet all this was not grim. The party did have a solid support among textile workers, with fully a third of their membership located in the textile mills, where they practically formed an alternative society. This support would remain a solid bastion for them, even during their hardest years. Yet the industrial war in France, the corruption of the Republic, and the revolutionary fire and conviction kept the Workers' Party from succumbing to defeat. Now, General George Boulanger was a career military officer who had been decorated for bravery in the Franco-Prussian War and had taken part in the suppression of the Paris Commune. Despite the blood of workers on his hands, Boulanger's later stronghold were in the working class districts of Paris. By the 1880s, he headed the war ministry, making a name for himself as a reformer by improving morale and efficiency, winning him the support of conscript soldiers. Boulanger was one of the loudest and most uncompromising voices demanding revenge against Germany, earning him the nickname of General Revenge, translation anyway. Boulanger also received support from the public as France expanded her colonial empire. In 1887, Boulanger continually provoked the Germans, and this led to a crisis which almost led to war, but the Germans backed down, and this shored up his nationalist credentials. Following a change in government, he was removed from the war ministry in May of 1887. The government decided to take a further step and remove him from Paris. Yet in July, when his train left, a crowd of supporters attempted to prevent his departure. His popularity was apparent during an election in the district of the Seine when he received 100,000 votes, despite not even being a candidate. A movement was born in 1888 and 1889. He gathered thousands of supporters in the face of a corrupt government, seemed more concerned with their own profit as opposed to the good of France. He won elections in 7 districts. He was seen not only by workers, but by many in the middle classes as a man on horseback who would avenge France's defeat at the hands of Germany, favor the common man, and revise the Republic's constitution. For enemies of the Republic, whether left-wing nationals, Blancists, anti-Semites, or exiled royalists who were providing the bulk of his financial backing, his rise portended the downfall of the hated regime. For all those dissatisfied with the Third Republic, Boulanger appeared to be their hope and savior. In 1889, January, he stood as a candidate in Paris, winning the election by 244,000 votes to 160,000. In the victory celebrations, he was urged to seize power via a coup. His nerve failed, and he did not take the opportunity. Finally, the Republic moved against the popular general with legal action. Fearing his immediate arrest, Boulanger fled to Belgium with his mistress. His image was destroyed overnight, and the movement surrounding him quickly collapsed. In 1891, he committed suicide. Now, despite the claims of Boulanger being a proto-socialist, this is belied by the evidence. According to William Irvine, who wrote a history of him, when a genuine socialist movement came on the scene the following decade, few Boulangers joined it. His appeal amongst the working class was actually the reason why the royalists supported him. Although many Boulangers describe themselves as socialists, their socialism was foreign to both democratic and revolutionary socialism, and had more in common with national socialism, which is to say it wasn't socialist at all. Yet the subsequent careers of Boulangers were not in the elitist politics of French conservatism or royalism, but in the mass politics they pioneered on the radical and nationalist right, advocating an authoritarian man on horseback who, on behalf of the people, would be neither left nor right, but would destroy the corrupt and decadent republic and restore France to national greatness. Now, for the Blancas, who were growing increasingly directionless in the late 1880s, the rise of Boulanger appeared to be a golden opportunity to bring down the bourgeois republic. The Blancas were intrigued and impressed as Boulanger gathered a movement around himself and received massive amounts of votes in elections, even if he didn't run in them. Moreover, the Blancas were receptive to his demagogic appeal, and they believed they could ride his coattails to power. However, Valiant was not willing to go this far, since he was not blind to the danger that Boulanger represented, and he was not willing to surrender principles for short-term political gain. A split occurred in 1888. A minority of Blancas agreed with Valiant, remaining in the CRC. However, the majority joined the Socialist Revolutionary Central Committee, or CCSR, staying loyal to Boulanger. The split in the Blancas party was the final nail in the coffin of the Jacobin communist tradition. In the wake of the split, both groups would abandon Blancism and move in different political directions that were more in line with the era of mass politics, Marxism, and nationalism. The Workers' Party did not dishonor themselves by supporting the Boulangist movement. Rather, they maintained a stubborn neutrality, believing it was of no concern to them. As Goude argued, the fight between Boulanger and the opportunists was a feud between two sections of the bourgeoisie that the working class had no stake in. He summed up his position with a phrase, "Between cholera and the plague, one does not choose." However, there was another trend in the Workers' Party that were attracted to Boulanger, such as Paul Lafargue, who was Marx's son-in-law. Lafargue believed that due to Boulanger's popularity, that socialists shouldn't attack him for fear of being isolated. Lafargue feared that if socialists attacked him, they would be mistaken as bourgeois Republicans and losing them votes. Frederick Engels, viewing Boulanger from afar, saw the threat of a right-wing military dictatorship, warning socialists in France, the finest thing of it all is that 3 months after these two congresses, Boulanger will in all probability be dictator of France. Do away with parliamentarism, imprison the judges, have a government, an authoritarian government, and crush Marxists, Blancas, and possibilists altogether, and then you will have just what you wanted. Engels recognized the danger of a Boulangist dictatorship as spelling the end not only of the socialist movement in France, but the Third Republic itself. For him, the question was not how to analyze Boulangism, but how to fight it. Engels was enraged at the passivity of the workers' parties, writing of the general's ties to royalists and the threat of war would be used to kill off the workers' movement. He warned that socialists not to let their hatred of the radicals in the Republic blind them to the threat of dictatorship. And he said, "You will get him all the same, the good Boulanger whom you crave, and the socialists will be his first victims. For a first consul has got to be impartial, and for every time he lets the blood of the stock exchange, he places another curb on the proletariat, if only to even things out." Engels told the workers that the defense of democracy was vital, in fact, so vital that its defense should not be left to the bourgeoisie. Rather, the preservation of democratic freedoms needed to be led by the socialists using revolutionary means. However, Engels castigated Lafarge's tailing of Boulanger, warning that it was not the job of socialists to just go along with the tide, even if it appeared momentarily popular, stating that such a course was bankrupt. Rather, socialists needed to take a long-term view and not just follow whatever was popular. And Engels said, "But if we are not to go against the popular current of momentary tomfoolery, what in the name of the devil is our business?" While Engels stressed to Lafarge and Goude was that the options before them were not simply between the opportunists and Boulanger, but that there was a third option of independent political action by the working class. He urged the socialists to put up their own candidates opposed to those of both camps. When the Marxists put up their own candidate in Paris in 1889, Engels hailed it as at least one step in the right direction by reclaiming the necessity of an independent socialist candidature. As Engels reminded Lafarge, for the past 20 years we've been advocating the formation of a party that was distinct from and opposed to all bourgeois parties. What Engels advocated for the Workers' Party was not renouncing the fight against Boulanger or seeing it as just another intra-bourgeois affair, but that the working class needed democratic freedom, needed to defend democratic freedoms with their own revolutionary means, as opposed to using ruling class moderation and mere reliance on the ballot box. And in order to defeat reaction, the working class needs their own flag in the field, an independent political party with its own revolutionary agenda. Now, for the Blancas who followed Boulanger, their fate was tragic. The Socialist Revolutionary Central Committee found themselves embroiled in financial scandal that, on top of their embrace of Boulanger, helped to discredit them as a revolutionary organization. In the late 1890s, they turned to nationalism, viewing their central task not in class conflict, but in the suppression of the notion of class altogether. For this reason, they expressed preference for the concept of the people as opposed to that of the working class in identifying participants in the revolutionary movement. They also adopted an anti-Semitic and anti-parliamentary philosophy, believing that Jews had taken over France through the corruption of parliament. But by the end of the 1890s, they had fallen into oblivion. Now, Valiant and his movement of the and his wing of the Blancas movement moved away from their own program, and in 1892, they adopted a new scientific program based upon Marxism. In 1898, they dissolved into a new formation, the Socialist Revolutionary Party, which is just a moderate reformist Marxist party. Valiant, who had already worked with Guy during the 1880s, had moved closer to the Workers' Party during the Boulanger crisis, which eventually led to the fusion between the Socialist Revolutionary Party and the Workers' Party in 1902 to form the Socialist Party of France. And in 1905, under the pressure from the Second International, the Socialist Party of France joined with the reformist-led French Socialist Party, yes, I know, to create the French section of the Workers' International, or the SFIO, who had a membership of 30,000. Almost done. Despite the neutrality and the passivity of the Workers' Party during the Boulanger's crisis, they managed to actually come through unscathed. Their reformist rivals had rallied to the defense of a corrupt republic, while the Blancas had torn themselves apart over whether to back Boulanger or to oppose him. A vacuum had been created on the socialist left, and the Workers' Party stepped in to fill it. After a decade as little more than a tiny propaganda group, at their 1890 Congress, they established themselves as a centralized and rationalized party structure, which actually gave them the first modern party in organization in France, and was soon emulated actually across the political spectrum. And their revolutionary confidence soaring, the Workers' Party also encouraged the creation of a new trade union federation, which didn't actually last long, and the celebration of May Day as a militant form of protest. By the early 1890s, they had their first electoral breakthroughs, winning control of several municipal governments and electing Goude and Lafarge to the Chamber of Deputies. The socialists team posed for still greater gains in the wake of the Panama corruption scandal, which exposed the underlying bourgeois nature of the Third Republic. However, the Workers' Party suffered a serious setback by remaining aloof from the Dreyfus Affair. Guy believed that the Dreyfus Affair, similar to the Boulanger's crisis, was a feud between two bourgeois factions in which workers had no stake. This time, their neutrality backfired, as it became clear that reactionaries, conservatives, and royalists were threatening to overthrow the republic. Reformist socialists, led by the great orator Jean Jaurès, stepped into the breach and rallied to the defense of the republic. And many Marxists abandoned their movement's neutrality to collaborate with bourgeois republicans and reformists in a pact of republican defense. Now, in 1902, the culmination of this collaboration was the entrance of the independent socialist Alexander Millerand into the government of bourgeois defense, led by, included a general as minister of war, and he was actually one of the butchers of the Paris Commune. and the entrance of Milleron into a bourgeois government split socialists into two camps: the ministerialists, who were led by Jaurès, who supported the government of Republican Defense, and the anti-ministerialists, led by the Workers' Party, who opposed socialist participation in a bourgeois government. Many Marxists abandoned their party's position by joining with the ministerialists, leading to widespread demoralization among those who remain opposed to any participation. Now, Jaurès appealed to the workers, stating that this new government would soon fulfill the dreams of a social republic by instituting major benefits to the working class. The Marxists appeared to be doomed to isolation by clinging to the purest principles. Yet those who remained true to their principles were proven correct. In 1901, during a major strike, the government sent in troops who shot the workers, and this discredited the advocates of Republican Defense. Furthermore, the promised reforms were shown to be hollow, showing that there was no promised transition from bourgeois democracy to social democracy. Very quickly, Milleron left the socialist movement and moved to the political right. For the Workers' Party, their intransigence did lead to temporary isolation, but they were shown to be correct. Subsequently, they were able to dictate the terms of unification of the French, of the socialist movement on a Marxist basis in 1905. Now, by the turn of the 20th century, Marxist socialism was well on its way to becoming the dominant tendency on the French left. It is true that Jules Guillet and the Workers' Party advocated a vulgarized and deterministic Marxism with a sectarian and economistic politics. Yet the Marxists were successfully able to adapt to the new era of mass politics, while Blanquists remained tied to a superseded mode of politics. Despite their limitations and drawbacks, the Workers' Party were pioneers. They walked on an unexplored terrain, who popularized socialism for hundreds of thousands of workers as an alternative society that would end capitalist exploitation and oppression. Thank you. That's it, yeah. So, before we take questions, comments, concerns, etc., I actually don't get paid to talk about this, nor does the center actually get paid to talk about this. So if you want to donate a few bucks, if you want to sign up for the email list, feel free. Pass it around, but feel free to bring up questions, comments, concerns, etc. Or to respond to each other as well. Yes.
What role does Marxism play, if any, in current French leftist discourse?
That's a good question. Marxist. I mean, there are more Marxists in France now than arguably than in 1905. But But a great many of the parties in France currently have some ties to Marxism. The French Socialist Party, I don't consider it socialist or Marxist, but it came out of that. There's various Trotskyist parties. There's the godforsaken Communist Party of France. But that's also a much wider discussion. But, there are also Marxists are still in union movements and academia, etc.
Yeah, could you cover a couple of topics? What did the Blanquists and their opponents in the Workers' Party, what was their perspective on French colonialism in Africa and Asia? And secondly, I don't know if this talk is supposed to go up to World War I.
No, it's not.
Okay, so I won't ask about Jean Jaurès and et cetera in World War I, but just maybe the colonialism.
Oh, sure, I can answer that. I purposely stopped in 1905, just because that's when the French, the Unified Party is formed. Mm-hmm. From all. But the French Workers' Party, I actually have, it's in one of the footnotes. Just give me one second. In 1895, at their 13th Congress, the Workers' Party, considering that colonial policy is one of the worst forms of capitalist exploitation, which tends exclusively to enlarge the fields of profits of the proprietary class at the expense of the blood and money of the producing proletariat, that goes on, and they formally condemn colonialism in that resolution, which that's actually standard hat for most of the parties of the Second International who do condemn colonialism. They didn't... it would actually be more after unification that there would be explicit anti-militarist propaganda amongst some socialists in the Army Corps, but it wasn't a central focus for them, and the Blancists, as far as I know, really didn't register on their radar. And as this is also the period, they're coming out of a period where French nationalism could arguably be considered progressive, where France was the revolutionary nation, and they never quite made that transition. And so they're still seeing French nationalism as progressive. So as far as I know, they never formally condemned colonialism. They did see France's job as to liberate and bring civilization to people. But increasingly, as time went on, that would be more from a very reactionary position. I mean, they came in line more with like these nationalists and royalists and others by the end of their existence. But internationalism was not necessarily the strong suit of Blancism, which was very Franco or even Parisian focused. I mean, the best we can say about the Workers' Party is that they did condemn colonialism, but it was, and they weren't, but they, it wasn't like a huge center of focus on them. But then again, they actually share, that's the thing that a lot of French leftists share. The French Communist Party, you know, had supported colonialization in Algeria going back to the 20s, actually, not just the 50s. So, and of course, they had rallied to World War I in 1914. We brought up World War I. Jerez, of course, as was a pacifist, and he did not support World War I, which got him killed, actually, by a crazed French nationalist. And Jules Guide, who the most orthodox of the orthodox, was a cabinet minister in the French government, who actually supported intervention against Soviet Russia in 1917. And he did not join the Communist Party when it was formed. He stayed in the French Socialist Party. So he's a minority. I hope that clear. Yeah. Okay. Anything else?
I have a question. Can you describe a little bit, if you know, what factions existed within Paris Commune between? Because it's like
I purposely the factions in the Commune. That's a good question. I purposely started after. But that's okay. In the Commune, you would see it's like three or four factions. One is the International, so that's followers of, say, the First International. These are not necessarily Marxists. So they're guided by various forms of syndicalism. Varlin, I forget his first name, he was like the leader of the First International in France, but he was more like a syndicalist and Proudhonist. So these were advocates of mutualism. There were Jacobins. And then there were the Blancists. And there's overlap at various points between them. But those are like the three main factions, along with various forms of independent Republicans and Socialists.
Well, first time I've heard that, about Jacobins. Because it's like, I've heard of Blancist, Marxist, but it's like, other, like, usually in our history textbook, it was like other small factions. Small groups.
No? Yeah. I mean, obviously Marx himself has The Civil War in France, which is a wonderful text. There's also the recent book, was it? Revolution and Democracy by Donny Glockenstein. It's actually a really good book. But those are like the essential big the major factions. And in my view, the Blancists have the better view on, I don't know, actually launching an offensive against the enemy when you can. And the First International had a better view on the type of worker organizations for an emancipated society, but neither one of them functioned very well as, say, an organized political party as we would understand it. But descendants of them, you know, would continue in the movements that came.
Yes. Can you just go into a little more detail on the Jacobins?
Sure.
How closely are they to the French Revolution Jacobins?
I mean, they're mostly drawing on that tradition. So the very early Jacobins are from the first French Revolution in the 1790s. They're overthrown in 1794. Mm-hmm. And they're still around at that point, you know, for a few years. But when Napoleon comes, all these movements are driven underground. And then after Napoleon's overthrown, you have, because France has so many governments in the 19th century, you have the Restoration. So the Bourbon monarchy comes back. And some of these Jacobins have become conservative, but new people follow that tradition. So through the various 19th century movements, there are people who adopt, say, Robespierre. They adopt Jacobinism. Sometimes it's a very confused way. And you see some of these people, like Blanqui, are moving in an explicitly communist direction. You see others who would later form the more established left bourgeois parties in France in later times. In fact, at one point, I believe it's actually called the Radical Socialists who draw upon this. They're an established political party who are neither radical nor socialist. They're just a regular political parties, like the Democratic Party is not Democratic, the Republican Party is not Republican. You know, they just use these names for gain. But and since the French Revolution is such a huge event, there are people there who claim that heritage. They will defend Robespierre and the Chamber of Deputies or something, but they're not radical at all. Mm-hmm. And it's just like they're drawing on that tradition.
But what specific issues separated them in the late 19th century from the
opponents? Anti-clericalism is a huge one. So, like, a lot of them just, like, they hate the church. They hate the Catholic Church. I mean, with good reason. The French Catholic Church is, like, a horrible, decrepit institution. So they want priests out of lay education. They want to instill Republican education among students. Whereas a lot of socialists and Marxists see a lot of that anti-clericalism as, say, a bourgeois distraction, because sometimes it's just used to whip up fervor in election periods. And of course, the Jacobins are not going to, they're not calling for the end of private property, you know, whereas, you know, the various forms of socialists are. So, like, the conclusion of, say, the Dreyfus Affair is the separation of church and state in France, formally, in, like, 1905 or so. And it's a victory for them. But one thing that categorizes a lot of Jacobins is their anti-clericalism. Yes?
The revolutionary labor movement in France, is it being emanating from this tradition, this revolutionary tradition of 1789, or is it somehow dominated by economic forces, the development of industry in France into the 19th century, or is it more theoretical than that? Is it a combination of all of them, with Marxism and this revolutionary tradition and economic developments?
It's a combination of all of them. Like, it's a standard, I think I'm on safe ground saying this. Various forms of French Marxism, socialism, communism, all will celebrate the 1789 revolution. You know, it was standard for workers to see the Republic as their defender. But some of that's backward looking, especially amongst a lot of these workers in small shops. But as capitalism is developing, that's bringing a new wave of the future. And some of that is drawing upon Marxism in a very vulgarized way. There is, leaving aside Jaurès, who, I mean, I don't really consider him that great a Marxist, but these early, Jules Guillet is not a theoretician. He's just a popularizer. There's no one with, like, the stature of Lenin, Trotsky, Karl Kautsky, anyone like that. Yet. But they are drawing upon, as you say, some of it is drawing upon this revolutionary tradition. There's a very, when initially the French Communist Party, I don't believe they celebrate, say, Bastille Day, but eventually they do when they adopt the Popular Front. And I don't think it was that difficult a turn for them, because France has that deep revolutionary tradition. Yeah. And, you know, a lot of, so, and it is, of course, drawing on these new economic developments. France was not the most capitalist country in the world when the first revolution breaks out. And even as I was describing, in the late 19th century, it was still probably lagging behind countries like Germany and Britain. But those forces were still in work. And it would only, I think it's only in like the 1950s that France is largely an urban country. I don't have the statistics on me, but those factors were still propelling them. In a certain sense, the French Workers' Party was looking way, way far ahead in what they were doing. But even then, it was still a very simplistic mode of analysis they were employing. Anything else? I know that this was a pretty obscure topic.
When you just ask this question. No, this term Jacobin. All right. Now, is this somehow connected with? Is it just France? When we say Jacobin, having to do with the French Revolution, or is it something else? Is it further, deeper than that?
I mean, the word Jacobins in other countries. I mean, just
That's right. It is.
I mean, there were Jacobins in England,
in England,
Wales.
That's right.
And there were, of course, followers of the French revolutionary traditions throughout Europe, South America, Simon Bolivar. Mm-hmm. And even people like Thomas Jefferson cast an admiring glance on them. But I'm referring more to this type of insurrectionary politics that they're drawing upon, this establishment of a secular republic. You know, and there is, like, of course, you know, as opposed to, say, the more established, say, radical socialists, the Jacobins or the Jacobin communists saw an act of violence as a revolutionary coup d'etat as necessary. And that they take, of course, from how the actual Jacobins came to power, which was through a mass movement, well, actually it was through kind of a mass movement and a seizure of power.
And a seizure.
Going back, you know, the first, very first Paris Commune in the 1790s. Yes?
Another question. You mentioned Blanqui Party, for example.
Yes.
You studied like French history so well, but it's like I never find any mention what was the name of that party. It was group. Usually, it's like in our textbook, it was like a group of supporter or Blanqui supporter, but it's like never mentioned anything about party, and particularly the name of the party.
Historians use the name Blanquist Party, and it's until the 1880s, there is no real party. I'm just kind of using like what historians have used. It's mostly a forms of secret societies and conspiracies that have gone through various names. So there is, the Society of Seasons, the Society of Families. Those are the early names of them. And there's the Central Revolutionary Committee. It's only really after he dies that the party, it's the Central Revolutionary Committee is formed. And that doesn't last long. It's an early version of what we would consider a political party.
Yeah, but according to my knowledge, Blanqui was never like close to Marxism.
No, he wasn't.
Socialism.
No.
Neither was Proudhon, and according to our textbook, Jean Jaurès was not Marxist.
Yeah, I mean, there's debate on how much Jaurès takes from Marxism. He had respect for Marx. Proudhon himself, was claimed as an anarchist, and I'm going to have anarchist friends watching this, but he's a raving anti-Semite, a supporter of the U.S. South, Napoleon III, hated women. Blanqui himself was not a Marxist, and he had a lot of disdain for a lot of Marxist theories. But he was a communist. The point is just that there are non-Marxist communists and socialists, I guess.
Did you say that Blanqui is part of the American South?
No, I said Proudhon did.
Proudhon, okay.
Which is not to his credit.
He was doing mostly syndicalist stuff, right?
It's more mutualist. Syndicalists would be more based on trade unions, which Proudhon was. So he was more like these, he wanted essentially these mutual aid, these cooperative societies, which when they tried them in France, actually did not work. Surprise. He rejected any form of independent political action, which actually is what Blanqui hated him for that. Part of Blanqui's whole thing was you need political action. And that was actually Marx projected for that too, among other reasons. There's of course the famous, one of Marx's earlier works is The Poverty of Philosophy, which is arguing against Proudhon, which is responding to the philosophy of poverty. It's probably worth to read both of them. I mean, I don't think much of Proudhon, but I have some friends who are Proudhonists, but I don't think much of Proudhon.
What faction was like the Proudhon and like his whole
movement? What's ironic about them is they are in the First International.
That's what I thought.
And it's really strange, even, which is why the Blancists don't support the First International, because the Proudhonist section opposes political action. And Marx is actually arguing from London, trying to get them to adopt political action. So you see this weird, so during the Commune, a lot of them rejected centralized leadership, military discipline, all the kind of stuff you actually do need to defend a successful revolution. And they were more into these cooperatives and worker-owned factories, which some of that's really good, but it's like, you do need to defend yourself. It's actually important. And after the Commune is crushed, there are still attempts to revive some of these mutual aid ideas, some of these cooperatives. But it's really more a step, because the French working class movement is starting to move on this level of political action, even though Proudhonists still have influence. And French socialism during this period is so eclectic that there is a lot of overlap among these tendencies. So you will see even the Marxist journals quoting some of these people. They'll quote Blanqui or they'll quote Proudhon. They don't really understand the theories they're espousing, I would say. Anything else? Yes?
You said you have friends who are that bourgeoisie actually exists today.
I have friends who are anarchists. And they,
well,
one of them says, like, I follow Proudhon.
They don't, they support the settlements of
no,
anti-Semitism, or?
They support his ideas on, say, cooperatives and mutual aid. They don't support his views on the South. There are Marxists who take issue with various aspects of Marx or what have you. Yes, I do have friends who are Proudhonists. I mean, forgive me. I just don't think much of Proudhon. I don't think much of most anarchist theorists personally, but that's another story. Yes, go ahead.
I don't know if you it's like related to Gorli for you, but when Marx and Engels created organized Union of Communists, were any kind of like chapter of this organization in France? Because I know about Belgium, I know about like England, I know about Germany, particularly Prussia, but I haven't heard anything about like France.
You mean the Union of Communists? Okay, there is something, I forget, it may be have a slightly different name, but there was, after the 1848 revolution, this effort to form some version of that, which did actually include French Blancs in exile. As far as I know, it didn't last very long. And that's actually kind of, I don't want to get too much into this, but it's also in that period where you see the first, Marx first actually adopts the term dictatorship of the proletariat. But, Marxism doesn't really become predominant to this period in France. Marx, like, most people don't read Marx in France. They have their own native tradition they're drawing on. This Union of Communists that existed after the 1848 revolution, it just doesn't last very long. And partly it's just like internal squabbles, theoretical differences, and the fact that after Napoleon III comes into power, all these people are driven underground. Yes, Jim.
So when did the French develop this solid intellectual tradition within Marxism?
That's a great question. I mean,
I guess it would be probably around after the Second World War.
I would say that too. I mean, even before the Second World War, you do see within the French, within and outside the French Communist Party, you know, there are people who associate, like Paul Nizan is one, Henry Lefebvre, yeah, okay, he's one. But I would agree with you, it's after the Second World War, because by that point, the French Communist Party is so huge, it's like 25% of the electorate. And despite the fact that their version of Marxism is pretty bad too, they have so much influence in terms of academia, economics, and everywhere, that's really the period where you see like a lot of flowering. So the historian Albert Sobel, he wrote some pioneering stuff on the French Revolution. He's a member of the party, but he's also a respected historian. Louis Althusser is, of course, a member of the French Communist Party, and Jean-Paul Sartre is on the periphery of the party for a lot of period. But I really would agree with you, it's after World War II. And this is a longer discussion that maybe a future lecture. I mean, I don't consider the French Communist Party to have ever actually been communist. I consider it more a social democratic party that has had communists in it. And that's partly how the French Communist Party was formed, which is actually the majority of the French socialists becoming the French Communist Party.
They changed name, but not ideology.
No. Like, I recently read the whole transcript of the fourth Comintern Congress, which is like 1,200 pages. So this is supposedly, you know, if you're, say, coming out of a Trotskyist background, this is when things are good, you know, this is when all these parties are healthy. Well, if you read that, there's like a six-hour speech Trotsky is about how shitty the French Communist Party is. You support colonialism. You're terribly organized. You have all these social democrats and centrists in your organization. And he just goes on about this for 6 hours. In French, I believe, too. Because he can speak French. But, so it's like they formally supported in 1922 the retention of Algeria as a French colony, which went against Comintern statutes of the famous 21 conditions, where you were supposed to support anti-colonial struggles. They supported, and they actually had to change that on the statute. They arguably didn't change that in their practice. And I have a Maoist friend of mine, and we've actually had a long discussion through. I think we both agree that, you know, the French Communist Party was like more pro-Moscow social democrats. And you can kind of see this if you look at them, how they behaved during World War II as well. The French Communist Party, with some very notable exceptions, eschewed any attempt to seize power on their own and institute socialism. They were more willing to tail De Gaulle. Yes?
Yeah, just in reference to what you just mentioned about how these leftists in France, leftists, they still agreed with the retention of Algeria with France. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking, what was Karl Kautsky's view about that? Well, I'm curious.
Karl Kautsky, he weren't here last month, but he was a part of the revisionism. But Karl Kautsky formally actually had a really good position on imperialism and anti-colonialism. He supported national liberation struggles. If you read The Road to Power, his 1909 work, I believe. He's seeing that as the wave of the future. Yeah. Now, he doesn't exactly support World War I, but he has this really bad position. Like, I'm not going to support it, but it's like I understand why they're doing it. I'm not going to oppose it in any way. I mean, he wrote a lot better than he actually practiced. But on paper, he actually did support national liberation struggles. That would eventually go by the wayside after World War I, where he was consumed with his hatred of Bolshevism because, I don't know, because they actually tried and succeeded.
No, I don't know. That's
no,
what
no, it's more just like there was an image, they shouldn't have succeeded.
This is someone who was the executor of Karl Marx's and Friedrich Engels.
That's actually Bernstein. That was actually Bernstein.
So he knew Marx and Engels.
Yes.
He knew them. He was in, they were in agreement. He was in agreement with them. So he sees this happen in 1917, Bolshevik Revolution, led by this guy named Lenin. And he says, well, okay, yeah, well, they're Marxists. and but their organization, he felt that, and this is what Marx and Engels did say, that they believed that it couldn't happen overnight. It's going to have to be a long process, and it wouldn't have to happen with the use of a democracy. It had to be in a democracy.
Yeah, but
it couldn't be in a dictatorship led by a capitalist dictatorship. That will not create the democracy. So in other words, that is a problem. I mean, that is a real problem. Maybe that means that people are going to have to raise arms and use guns and all. But if you have a democracy, even if it's on paper, but at least if they have laws set up, you can still create, trade unions, free trade unions, and all this, which leads to the elimination of capital.
It doesn't work. Condemnation of the Bolshevik Revolution was immature. And in Germany, after World War I, they did establish a democracy, and they organized right-wing death squads to kill communists. They had laws. They had a constitution.
I understand that.
And we also know what happened in Chile with Salvador Allende, which was a formal democracy, where the army decided to protect order and overthrow the government that was unarmed.
So what comes now? I mean, what exists now? What do we have in the Soviet Union now?
Well, there is no Soviet Union.
There is, in the former Soviet Union.
Capitalism
exists. We have capitalism, right? And how did that happen?
That's a longer question about how Gorbachev...
Yeah, I can answer this question.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, because I was there, I used to live. I became member of Communist Party of Soviet Union in 1980. So the whole period, it was in front of me. I was kicked out of the party in 1988 when I started to raise the group of opposition to ЦК, to politics of ЦК. So I was kicked out of the party. So in 1991, I was officially not member of Communist Party anymore. But what happened is very simple. After Stalin died, Khrushchev came to power. Khrushchev, honestly, he never tell him openly that he is Trotskyist, but he was Trotskyist, and he was initially, when it was the party struggle, party divided on between Stalinist and Trotskyist. Trotskyist was in support of world revolution, and Stalin is was supporting socialism in one country. I'm just generalizing. When Khrushchev came to power in 1953, first thing what he did, it was elimination, murder of Lavrenti Beria. The only person who can stop him, because he had power. He was minister of considered KGB chair. And after that, Khrushchev started every what Stalin did, he started to do it bad. That it continued. Brezhnev was considered almost 20 years, it was trying to keep it not doing anything backward, not doing anything, it was stagnation, literally, in economic, in ideology sense. It was several times was arguing in CK of our Lithuanian Compartil that I was arguing with the secretary of ideology. He doesn't know Marx. He never read Marx. He never read Lenin. But he arguing with me, and finally he told me about party discipline. We told you kind of like to go in that direction, you have to go in that direction. And it would like, it's against Lenin, it's against everything what Lenin stand for.
Right.
And that it was like situation. And it was a lot of confusion part. And when Gorbachev started to tell about like, we have to improve socialism, something like that. Yeah, I was initially supporting him because it's like, obviously we need to improve socialism because it's like, we cannot like, kind of like go neither like forward, neither backward. We have to move somewhere. Like, we're standing in one place. But the problem, the most problem was that what happened with Communist Party, that Communist elite, particularly started with Khrushchev time, the member, the top elite, they started like to try to pass their all privileges, everything to their children. And it wasn't working all the time. So like, I believe that by Gorbachev time, by 1985, they figured out that like, screw that, like socialism, pardon my French, and we are going to kind of like to liquidate it and to just like divide the property between themselves. And based on, I was by that time, I was out of Soviet Union because it was like already order on my arrest. Like I was like hunted all 15 former Soviet Republic. I managed like to escape to Poland, Germany, Israel. After that, I presume that in Israel they wouldn't look for me there because I have no like any relationship to Jews. I remember that it was time when it's like, particularly when Lithuania became independent, they literally like, they divided their everything what belonged to country between themselves. The people were sitting there. Who won that factory? I was there, I was actually like, it was like the moment when I like, I was like almost caught. Because I was like so pissed off, like they were sitting there and divided the property that doesn't belong to them. It's like, who won this factory? Who won that, like, who won railway? Railway? No, and they like, who won that oil pump? Who won that oil, like, refinery? It was like this. People were sitting there, the so-called communists, and to divide it that it's like between themselves. Right now, look at them. One of them, like a leader of the conservative party. Not the conservative party, it's called conservative, but it's actually a Nazi party, I would say. That show you how, like, what leadership about this party. Obviously, when it's like, when captain and all crew, the whole effort is like to sink the ship. The passenger of that ship cannot save that ship because it's like, in some instances, they would like to kind of like to preserve the ship, but they don't know how. And particularly, they were like kicked out of their park. That it's like, sorry, it was like a very hectic, but it's like, that it's what it was. What destroyed Soviet Union? It was like the moment when we started to drift it away from Marx and Lenin ideology, we were like doomed. The moment when we like started like to drift like to any way from that, like when we were doomed. And that it's like, and particularly we started like 1961. It was actually it was like party started like separate themselves from like worker class. it was kind of government became kind of like not responsible to worker class, and it was like a lot of stuff. It was going under the table. I was like 2 years old in 1961, but it like my father. I remember my father came from like all this. Like he was a member of CK and secretary of CK, and he came home and he was like pissed off. He was like my mother had like to hide his like gun. He got like his gun as like. During WW2, she read, literally hid the gun in my bed under me, like, and I was sleeping on that gun because my father would never look at gun under my bed, because he was like close to kill some of those bastards. But it was like that's why he didn't leave alone. I don't know if.
Does anyone else have? Other points? I don't.
Sorry.
You know, it's okay. Thank you. And that's a very interesting perspective. But we're very far from France.
Yeah.
It's a great. It's a huge topic, but it's also. It's not something I'm going to get into.
Yeah. Well, this is also far from France.
That's
but
okay.
Let's
very
give
far
it one
from
final
France. Technically.
Since we're dusting off old Russian socialists, among others, French socialists as well. Can you just briefly assess Julius Martov? I know he, like Lenin, he opposed World War I as an imperialist
mm-hmm.
war on all sides. And he, although he opposed the Bolshevik seizure of power, but he was somewhat sympathetic to them. But nonetheless, of course, eventually, not long after Trotsky tells me the dustbin of history, which is such a great phrase, that particular thing has gone into the language of many, many countries, even if no one knows exactly where it originated, but apparently it originated with Trotsky versus Martov.
Yeah.
Anyway, could you just move to Martov a little bit?
I mean, in terms of Martov, I mean, it wasn't just that he liked Lenin. Lenin personally liked him, too, and it caused him a great deal of stress because they worked together in St. Petersburg, or what was then St. Petersburg, in the Emancipation of Labor together. There's pictures, you know, showing, like, their editorial staff. So, Martov, I mean, I believe it was during one of the Republican debates, and it might have actually been the late lamented Ted Cruz, who compared the Democratic debate between Bolsheviks and Mensheviks, which is actually unfair to the Mensheviks as much as I actually dislike them. Martov was a serious Marxist intellectual. No, I don't agree with like his positions in 1917 and onward, but there was some nuance to him, but you know, clearly he was not for the revolution in the sense that, say, Lenin or Trotsky or all of them were in that year. But he was a serious intellectual. I haven't done like an extensive amount of research. I've read very little of Martov.
Did he have political evolution after, say,
he went into exile, actually. I think somehow Lenin arranged that. And I forget where he ended up. But he was still considered himself, whether he was, that's a different story. He still considered himself a socialist and a Marxist. And he was part of, I would probably classify them as a minority of the Mensheviks who offered at various times critical support to the Bolshevik government. He may be, him and the Mensheviks may be a topic for a future discussion, but that requires far more reading on my part. But I do know the Marxist Internet Archive, God bless them, has a Martov archive there. But no, like Lenin personally thought very highly of him, and you know, it actually supposedly like the break with the Mensheviks, like Lenin had like nervous problems because of that, because it wasn't just a political split; it was also a personal split.
The funny story about that: not a lot of history books mentioned that, but Martov, together with Lenin, was the one who created the Bolshevik Party. But after that, it was like two bear in one hole. They cannot live peacefully. And everybody was a leader. And everybody was like trying to. It was like mostly, like I would say, like mostly personal then it's like ideology, but later on, I would say Lenin became more, kind of like, he stayed the course, but Marx also started like, people with age, I presume, like, they started like to drift it more toward like, Mensheviks, and obviously Mensheviks is like, embrace him with like, because he was like big name in Russian Social Democratic Workers' Party. Sorry.
No, that's okay.
Because I know the history and.
Any other comments, concerns? Again, we have an event on Wednesday on Chelsea Manning, and a week from Monday, if you want to learn about the 50th anniversary of the Chinese Cultural Revolution.
Oh, I will be there.
Okay, I should be there as well. So I guess we can call it a wrap. So thank you all for coming. Thank you all. For